I'm working with someone that I used to work with.
So this is about streaks and tips, and this is basically 3 years behind the scenes. Nobody, when I first got into the business, I was fortunate enough to get a grant from UCLA to go to film school, which is why the reason why I give this talk. I've given it to a couple colleges already in California. I moved here about 2 years ago. I'm retired, but I still love film and whatever I can do to help them out. So for some of you, probably don't know what streaks and tips are, but it's kind of like what filmmaking is all about. It's a lot of cardboard and things like that that people don't realize. And so streaks and tips is an aerosol spray can of dulling paint. It's used to cheat the look, to make things look older. And some DPs use it also to dull shiny surfaces. Because we need to, get as much as you can out of the production. Now, the big thing is the script. I mean, how many times have we seen a movie they made for $60 million and it really was bad? And why was it bad? Probably because the script was bad. You want to check the format, you want to check the continuity, you want to check the slug lines, and then when you're reading, you're thinking about, is this script like in my budget that we have or we're thinking about? Nobody's going to really say, hey, just give us a script and we'll fund it. First thing they're going to want to know is how much. The second thing is how long. The first read is to read for the story content. I like to do that. Just gets it right there from the start, and all I concentrate is what the story is about. The second read is in part where I start breaking it down in my mind. And I'm also looking at, how many effects are in this thing, where are we going with this as far as money, how many locations, things like that. You could probably do a stage play like A Streetcar Named Desire for about $75,000 because it pretty much could play all on a set. But obviously Die Hard, forget it. So the big question is, the script that I'm handed, and that's what they used to do, is give me a script and say, how much and how long? This is a lot of stuff I run into when I just get scripts, and people give me scripts where maybe they didn't use one of the final draft or script writer. There's probably a couple more out there. I really suggest that if you want to write, this is the route to go. I mean, you can't beat the format. You don't have to worry about your margins and your fonts. The wrong fonts and margins will give inaccurate page count. We're going to get to that. Page count for us is all about how long is it going to take. This is important, as you know, for production and how much are we going to spend time-wise on the scene. This is a funny thing I run into. You might say, oh, I couldn't believe this would happen. Check all the characters' names. And I like real detailed slug lines. John is John. Don't change it to John. I've seen this a couple of times. They'll change the spelling. Maybe they're in a rush or something. Anyways, all of a sudden that says to me we have two actors. And what I usually do by the second read is I'll go back to the writer and I'll give him some notes of things that jump out at me. I'm not a script editor, but if I see a word that's really misspelled, it'll never get past the agent or the actor or the producer or director. That goes right out the window. Slug lines should be the same description throughout. The slug lines should include detail as to which room. This becomes important in your scheduling, as you will most likely be shooting out of sequence, and therefore a proper slug line will help the actors and department heads know where you are in the story. And a good example is this one here. I get a lot of scripts. It's Joe's house. I'm going, well, where are we in Joe's house, just because the scene before that was Joe's house, it doesn't mean we're same in the same room. A common writer's mistake I see is Joe, and I do this too, I write just for exercise, Joe walks into a kitchen, takes a glass into the bedroom, and puts it next to the bedroom table. We've got two scenes here. And we need to know that because we're lighting two rooms. I mean, you know, you might say, well, it was a tracking shot. Well, that's not how I see it. The first being the kitchen, the second being the bedroom. The definition of a scene is whenever time or place change. Okay, so we read the script, we're doing the breakdowns, we go to the shooting script, and then we go to the schedule, we go to the budget, you set up the necessary legal LLC, you set up your insurance, PA is basically your patent for the Library of Congress. You got to have that in order to get your SAG work done. Establish your production office, your war room, hook it up with phones, internet, order your SAG paperwork, interview all potential crews, backup, interns, start crew papers, which will be their contract. It'll be an I-9 form, be a tax form, it'll be a shooting schedule. build your crew and vendors list, meet with the unions, cut deals if you can, if you're looking for the lower budget contracts. At least in California, I don't think they have it here yet, but they have different tiers. So you can do like a, pretty much under $5 million, it's very tough to do a non-union film here. Get wardrobe started. They will also be doing all their own breakdowns as well. I mean, I'll give them their one-line budget from the budget, and I will also give them my breakdown. My breakdown is basically what I see in the script, and we'll get to the breakdown here in a second. Lock your locations, have backups. We had a place one time, and we're going the next day. I called the guy. I said, well, we'll be out there tomorrow morning, 7 o'clock, bright and early. He said, I want to be a producer, and I want a percentage of the film now. So it was kind of a switch and bait. You know, we had a contract, and he was switching it on us. And, you know, the other side of the point is that, we had a backup to go to. Otherwise, the whole thing about filming is the camera cannot just sit there. It's got to be working. Otherwise, money's just going out the window. Meet with the FX people, the stunt people, a lot of these people here. You want to get them, everybody on board, what camera we're using, what aspect of the lens we're using, right from the get-go. So there's no surprises when you get the post and they go, oh, we didn't know you were going to be doing this. And then, of course, you meet in conference with the keys and sub-keys, which would be your best boys. Work on transportation. Start putting your accommodations together, travel. You know, if you're going out of state, you'd have to deal with all the travel and drivers, picking them up and everything else in the hotels. I shot Vegas 3 times. We never paid for a hotel room. I told them the crew will spend every dime here, and they did. Establish production accounting. I mean, you can get an accountant if it's a lower. What I use is I use QuickBooks, and what I've done is I've taken the Movie Magic budget, and I've now imported it into QuickBooks so I can work through it there. The good thing about that is at any point I can go in and take a look and see what department's ahead or what department's behind, and maybe I can move money around to help out the other department, or I need to talk to them. Get your Star Wagons or the equivalent. Plan your catering and Crafty. Crafty's usually pretty easy to deal with. Catering is always a surprise, tries to be a surprise to me. I always try to nail them down to what I call OTD, out the door. You know, because they'll say, you'll say, how much a plate? I go, okay. I say, how much a plate? Okay, it's $9, $12 a plate, whatever. And then they'll go back, oh, but the service. Oh, but we have to deliver. Well, I said OTD. Set a production calendar, a timeline, which should include when the casting starts, and it goes all the way through. And basically, I just take like a calendar from, from Microsoft or something, take a blank one, and then I just figure, things out from there. So you put your prep in there, you'd put when you're gonna lock your cast down in there. So you always have a date that you're going to that you have to meet. And then one of the things we do is we go out with the keys, which would basically be my juicers, my grips. Juicers being electricians, and so I'd be their best boy, and the key. And so we'd go out, we'd take a look at the locations, and then we go, the generator's going to be this far away, we're going to need more distribution, which is basically cabling, and we might need a scissor lift because we might need to put the lights up. And, you know, this is good to have your keys out there so you don't have any surprises when you get out there. This kind of gets into, at least for me, is the fun part. I'll try and show you what a schedule looks like with the colors on it. It becomes a video game. Discovering the elements, grouping the like elements. For instance, all the locations, all the sets. I mean, basically, the ideal thing is when I turn in my first schedule, I always tell everybody that, or my producers above me, that this is the best bet, and I'm giving it to you, and now you're going to screw it up on me. And what they're going to do is they're going to tell me, oh, this actor can't start till this date, and so you start moving things around. I do this, not everybody does this. But I, when I start reading a script, I kind of do a timeline of the day. So, like I say, if they're eating breakfast, it's going to probably be, you know, I'll just pick a random number like 8 a.m. And if they end of the day, they're eating dinner, then I'm going to say that's like 6:30 or 7 or whatever. I do that mainly because some DPs really appreciate knowing what time of the day they've got a light for. The importance of the script days. Okay, day one means the first day in the script, okay? And then you'd go to that night, that would be night one, and so forth. We tell our audience that the day has changed by changing wardrobes. That's one of the ways. And this is where you find out how many wardrobes you're going to need. At least in a lot of scripts I've read, especially in the independent world. I've worked for the independent world, and then I've worked what they call the quasi-independent world, where we had a office on one of the studios, like Paramount or one of those places. And sometimes they do that because, well, I think one of the reasons they may do it is, and we'll get to that in a minute, because we would not be a signature to all the unions. Well, a studio would be a signature to all the unions. So it's a money thing. So if you've ever seen like The Night of the Condor, you know, it pretty much takes place over 2 days. And of course that saves on wardrobes, saves on time changing people. I did 9 action pictures and the guy wrote these things and they all took 1 day. And we'd shoot over 30 days and the actor would be exhausted because he literally just ran the whole time. Now, this is not a true breakdown sheet because I'm not really a computer guy, even though I've learned quite a lot on it. I'm working now into bringing my actual sheet from Movie Magic, and we can get into that later. Movie Magic is what I use. There are a couple other programs out there, but they really make everything work. So this would be how a scene would break down. I'm giving you an example here. I have one mistake there. Anybody can? This would be European time, so I'll give it to you. It's nighttime and it's really 1 p.m.
Do you use script boards?
You know, when I first started, I was in school and we had to do it from scratch. So, you know, I didn't have a lot of money, so I cut, shirt boards from the laundry into strips, and I did it that way. And they were at first, all the producers and directors, they wanted the board. They had to have the hard board. And, you know, I've seen nightmares where somebody drops the board, and it's like, oh, man. Now everybody pretty much takes a PDF. My PDFs come colored also. Unfortunately, this one you won't see, but I do have it on another piece. Okay, so we're in script day 2, we're on script page 3, and the pages are 2 4/8. And we have our cast. These numbers are in Movie Magic. And this is how Movie Magic, which is what I use for scheduling, keeps track of everything. And you have your extras here. You have some of your props. If we go to the next one, I don't get into a lot of description on this because that's not really my job. That's really the art department's job and the prop people to decide. But I know that if there's a prop mentioned, it better be on the set because it's on the board. So now you've got all this put together. You want to import this into your schedule. It's so simple, really. You just press a button, bang, it happens. And you have all this information. And of course, the schedule determines how many days the elements, like the cast and the set works. This is where a page count of how much work your schedule in a day and thereafter. Now, this is, just for fun, I looked this up on Google the other day, and they said, oh, it's an AD thing. You don't have to worry about it. So an eighth of a page is really what it is. It's the text on the page is 8 inches. Okay, so we don't count the margins. And so when you're starting out, you fold it into eighths. After a couple of years, you just know where it is. And a lot of people don't realize, a lot of producers or directors that I've worked with, when I give them the Movie Magic schedule, they look at it, and I have to tell them, you've got to read it from the bottom up. That's just how it's designed. Once your schedule breakdowns are done, you should match up the scene numbers on the script. I usually insist on getting the script and final draft with no scene numbers, mainly because I'm probably going to find a scene in there where the guy took the water from the kitchen and walked into the bedroom, and now I have two scenes. So at some point, I'm going to have to match that up. I'm going to have to put it in that scene. You'll ask the writers to do it, but they don't usually want to do it. So I'll go ahead and put another scene in there, and then I'll check it against my breakdowns and see if all our numbers are right. Now this is kind of a sample of a shooting schedule. Well, basically the colors are yellow would be day, basically. Exterior night is blue. Interior night is green. And you can play around with more colors if you want to put it in there. So you can look at this and you read it from the bottom up. So you know you have 6 4/8 pages to shoot that day. That's a good amount. That's a healthy amount. But we're also on a set, and all these sets are right next to each other, so you can just move from one to the other. So we don't mind the wardrobe change that much. You know, everything's on the studio, we're right there. A rule of thumb usually is for me is women about an hour in makeup in the beginning of the day. You know, maybe hair, depending on what they want to do. Watch your hairdresser. She may be wanting to come up with some extravagant hairdos, which could just kill you when you go back, when you're trying to save time. Okay. Before we move on, anything on the schedule or breakdowns?
How do you nail down whoever's bringing the money to the table on number of days? How do you pick that, how many days you want to shoot between all the money people and the producers and the director and everybody?
Okay, so what you're saying is?
Because number of days dictates how many pages a day, dictates whether you can actually make the movie.
Good point, yeah. You know, they say when you get out of USC, you should be doing 8 pages a day. I think that's a lot. If you're doing an action feature, if you do a page or a half a page, it might be a big day. So then again, is it a stage play or is it an epic big budget? And here's pretty much what I define. And like for under $5 million, I mean, you're gonna probably go for like 24 days. And you could have some union, but you have to decide which union that's gonna be. You're definitely gonna have SAG. And I actually like having one union on board at least, because they won't work you 36 hours then. They won't even work you over 12 because they don't want to get into the overtime. Now, this is just some stuff that I put on here for people if they want to find out about the different resources that are available. Film USA has, like, every state, they'll tell you what the tax incentives are. SAG, you can go to SAG, and they have that tier level, where I think if you're in the top level, the actors are making 700 plus a day, which is pretty good money. If you're making like a $100,000 feature, they're making $100 a day. So it's worth taking a look at and seeing if your where your film fits. And then, of course, there's some in between there also. There's the modified low, which I think is $268 a day. But, you know, read it, because, I mean, in the modified modified low, I believe you have to have a theatrical release, but you can, what they do, four-walled if you need to, which means you rent a theater. Take a look at IATSE. They don't give, as far as I know, there's no real deals in New Mexico. California does have a tier at, at 1.3 million and then other numbers. Now, I strongly believe that the right to work bill that they had here was nothing to do with what right to work is all about. I won't get into the political part of it, but I think it was really all about the office workers in Albuquerque working for Martinez and who was going to take control here. But to me, it really means that you have the right to work in California. It means that you can work non-union. Where this really helps out is this helps out the small independents. I believe New Mexico has a gap. What we have is we have the student films, and then we have the $100 million films that come here. And because of that, there's a lot of people that can't pick up the education, especially in middle management, like the ADs and the PMs and the line producers, to go on to the bigger films. And that's why I would say 90% of the big films, maybe even more than that, bring all their management teams from California or Boston or wherever. Unfortunately, I was one of those teams. We used to go to Arizona all the time. We brought the whole crew. And, you know, they'll say, well, you know, we want our people because we don't know if we can trust people. Well, you know, if there was a, we give these people a big tax cut, and if we could put in something like saying that they have to at least have a DGA trainee. I mean, what I'm talking about here is the community college is training grips and electric, and I think that's good. These are $20 an hour jobs. DGA ADs making about $1,600 a day. And so you look at the difference in the money here. That AD can afford a car. He can afford a house. He's making serious money. And what the DGA has done recently, which I don't understand at all, if you work over 12 hours, you get an automatic extra day. So you get two paychecks for the day, for the one day. And believe me, it's very easy for an AD to work over 12. So these are kind of just general, you know, a one-page script is about 1 minute on the screen. You know, this is rule of thumb. It's not made in concrete or anything. I kind of try and shoot a one script page every 2 hours of production time. And then depending on how big the room is, like this room here, I would give my DP maybe 45 minutes to do a turnaround on it. And here we get into the makeup times. Men are 10 to 15, I mean, unless, you know, you've got like somebody with needs a lot of makeup, like Woods. Directors hate this, but if you start getting behind, you gotta combine the shots, get off the dolly, go to your sticks, because you gotta make up time. You know, my budgets I work with, there is no more money. So, and the studios just go, oh, sure, we'll just go another couple of million. Loading time, you know, this is probably for, we're probably talking like a 10-ton grip and electric here. And these guys should be able to load in 1 or 2 hours, depending, you know, you don't want to walk up. Preferably you find your set on ground floor. And we could always get into, if you go to the second floor, what happens. And these guys, everything's on wheels. I mean, they open the door, and most of your grip equipment just comes out on little dollies. And the same with you have a lighting cart, everything comes out on wheels. Okay, this happens to you all the time. You have especially in the independents, you've only got money for this actor for one day, but he's got to play two locations. So you got to cheat it. One of the cheats we do a lot is, let's say he can't make it to the party. Okay, we'll shoot the party scene. We'll take a picture that's in the party scene. We'll get a couple of extras, and we will shoot him with the picture behind him and the extras. I did one with a helicopter shot where the guy wasn't there for the helicopter. So we had an extra kind of get out of the helicopter. He was long shot, so we didn't see his face. And then we just did a shot of his face with the sky behind him. It cuts, looks beautiful. I always love this because the directors go, where's all the trucks and everything? And, as he gets in his Porsche and drives 100 miles down the road. So I always kind of rule of thumb is I figure, for 1 hour a car does, it's going to take the trucks 2 hours. In L.A., we move everything at 3 o'clock in the morning. This would be a dream here. A runaway production. This is when the patients run the asylum. I've actually seen this happen with weak producers who, they don't want to get involved. The first week, there seems to be this whole juggling thing, like who's going to run it? Is a crew going to have their own way and, have steak dinners for lunch every day or whatever? So you really need to establish that chain of command. One thing I make sure is, in my earlier days, I had somebody do this. They actually, the key grip called in all this equipment. Well, he never went through the office, so it wouldn't be in our budget. And maybe he was renting it from his friend. I don't know. So I really make it just two people. And that way, when the bills come in, there's no surprises. This is another thing I run into sometimes. The director is the producer. It's my movie. Okay, we only have this amount of money. I know, but I got to have this front of a building built over here. And you go, well, you're going to go over budget if we do this. I got to have it. Try and get them to sign off on it. They'll never sign it. They'll say, oh, sure, I'll sign off on it. They almost never do. But, it's his money if this is the type of situation. So you just make a note of it in your production notes that, this is what happened. Is there any questions up to this point?
Yeah. Can you talk about the difference between shooting indoors and outdoors, day and night, in terms of cost-wise?
For two things. At nighttime, I feel that it's going to take longer to get the shots. Part of this is because, especially if you're coming, basically what we usually do, we build into it. So we'll go later every day. So that by the time you get in the night, you're not too bad, but it's still, your bodies and your chemical are telling you it's nighttime, and like around 1 o'clock, you want to go to sleep. I mean, you're supposed to be shooting till 5 a.m. I mean, everybody starts dragging. I would prefer to do daylight whenever I can. And you can certainly cheat, inside for nighttime very easily. Now, this is kind of general hiring things that I've come across, and that is, personally, most of my friends are director of photography, so I have more friends who are director of photography than who are producers, and so I kind of have a soft point for them. But this is what I've run into over the years, and that is, if the DP has his own crew, and doesn't have his own crew, and he's not making his day, he can just turn to you and he can say, if you'd hired my gaffer, we'd be making our day now. Well, okay. Here's the other thing we run into a lot. Okay, the DP will say, I got a camera. Okay, now here's the problem with that camera. The camera breaks down. Okay, where are you going to get another camera? Like I said, the whole thing is about we usually carry two cameras anyways. But in any case, a light breaks down, that the gaffer owns his own truck. The light breaks down. Okay, so what are you going to do? he doesn't have a shop behind him. That's why I usually like to do a deal with somebody who has a truck but has a relationship with a vendor. That way you're covered. I mean, you know, the minute something goes down on my sets, the PA's already running to the vendor. And what I sometimes do is I'll have the vendor start driving towards us. And they'll meet halfway or something. We talked a little bit about the OTD. California is really the land of bait and switch. People promise you anything, and then at the last minute you find out what you're really getting for it. So, you know, make sure your contracts are good. And like I say, I really, you know, when they said, well, it's going to be about this much. No. How much? Meals. Meals are very important because it's really the only break in the day for the crew. I mean, if you're moving right along, your camera people never stop. The general rule is we feed everybody every 6 hours. I'm a strong believer in that. It's usually a catered meal, and it's not because we're such nice guys. It's because we don't want you leaving the set, because you're going to go off to McDonald's. We're not going to see you for an hour and a half. You know, if you do that, they come back, oh, we had traffic. You know, sure, okay. In the meantime, everybody's sitting around waiting for them. And then there's always the grace period, which I used to use a lot. And I think it's very important that you bring the crew into it. All my crews have never denied me the 12 minutes. Once you go to the 15 minutes, you're on a meal penalty. So at 12, so I usually ask them when, if we're going to go over, you know, the director says, I got to get this scene. We've done 6 takes. I know we're going to get the next one. So I'll ask for grace. I stay away from apartment buildings, condos. Why? Noise, stairs, dealing more people, contracts, quietness of it's a real problem. Harder to get the equipment upstairs, you're gonna need scissor lifts for your lights. Parking could be a problem in the neighborhood. I always check neighborhood construction. Hopefully the day you arrive, somebody isn't there with a jackhammer. Wrap, I make sure everybody is paid out the last day. You've got 2 weeks to pay them. I don't do it that way. I have everybody's checks as close as I can do it. I mean, there will be some overtime and there will be some other small checks, but for the most part, I like, especially on the independent shows, I want everybody to walk away with their money. You gotta do a final cast list for SAG. I usually have, what I usually do is I have a SAG accounting firm do their checks. That way I never have any problem with SAG. And they also will do the cast list for you. Make sure all equipment and props are back at vendors. I send an email to vendors declaring, okay, you have to have, I mean, every now and then you get this bill 3 months after the show wrapped. You know, what is this bill for? This is something that actually did happen. I call it my $250 straw hat. The art department declared all props had been returned. The rental cost on this thing was like, you know, maybe $20 a week or something ridiculous. It's a $150 hat. Turned out to be a $250 hat. Make sure all the elements of the show are delivered to the vendors for post. And this is going to be basically your sound and your footage.
Could I ask you a question?
Sure.
From what you know about Lone Ranger, yeah. What elements of that do you think caused so much cost overruns and expensive production costs?
You know, I can't really talk on that, but I can talk on Waterworld, because my friend was a production manager on that, and talk about things getting out of control. First of all, Kevin Costner did not want to travel with the actors on the regular ferry that went out to the island that they built. He had to have his own boat, which was $90,000 a month, I believe. So who authorized that? Here's another problem that happened there. This is when you have all the producers sitting around at Universal. Nobody's reading these production reports coming in. I mean, I would have flagged that in a second. Another thing is what they did was they painted all those buildings, And then they said, you know what we're going to do? They got permission to sink it, and it was going to be for the fish. Well, then they found out the paint was toxic. So now they had to raise the whole island again and destroy it another way. So just thinking sometimes, I guess.
Do you have any production and wine producing tips for a television series? Or?
I've done a couple of TV series. I mean, the good thing about them is you usually have the same crew, so you only hire once, which is nice. Let's see, what else can I think about it? Otherwise, it runs pretty much like a feature. You know, it's just, I mean, the ones I did one for a Russian company, and, you know, we kind of did like three shows in one. You know, we'd shoot part of another show while we're shooting one show. And the actors didn't like that, but they land up getting double paychecks for it.
Thank you. I wanted to mention we do have agreements with IATSE and Teamsters for low-budget films.
And where is the cutoff on that?
The IATSE, the agreement with them is we pay, we need to negotiate our own prices with the department heads,
okay,
key grips and all that. And then we have to offer step-up positions to the crew and pay them at the lower position. So if we have a grip that grip moves up into a gaffer, they move up to a gaffer, but we can pay them at the grip pay rate. And then the pension and health is a little bit less.
That's good. That
and
helps.
Then the Teamsters, we need a transportation coordinator and one driver. That's it.
That's good. Yeah, it's like the cable TV.
Right. And then they allow a crew to drive 5-ton trucks. Otherwise, the Teamster captain and the driver are driving back and forth.
And now, are the location managers of the Teamsters here?
No, location managers are IATSE, right?
Local 480.
They're 480.
And I think the other one, let's see. So another thing is strange to me, at least the last time I checked, the people who worked in the IA office are not in a union and do not have the same benefits as the people who work in IA. Just something strange. So IA really wants to protect their people. Another thing I'd love to see, and we have this in California, is especially on these big budget films that come here, first 60 extras are SAG. So they are getting pension, they're getting a decent rate, and the rest are regular wage. But at least that way more people are covered.
I've always been curious about what the political or economic advantage is to a company, to a production company, to make a lead actor into a producer, even though they've never been a producer in their life, and I know they get extra money, but I mean, what leverage does that actor have to become a producer? What's the advantage to the production company?
Money. They're thinking this guy can bring money, this guy can close the deal with the studio for it.
But my personal experience, I've seen them act, I've seen when they start making decisions as a producer, it slows things down, it screws things up.
For sure.
Only because they've been allowed to be a producer.
For sure.
So then who, can't the executive producer, wrangle them in such a way that's another way that things get out of hand and overages and so on.
Well, you know, the actor can always say, I'm taking my football and going home. I've done three films with Eric Roberts. One of the films I didn't do with him, he did take his football and go home, and he got blacklisted for quite a few years. Anybody else?
On that note, when you negotiate with the actor's agent, many times there's a production company that comes attached with that actor, and it puts that actor in the producer role. But it's not only him as a producer. It may be his producing partner from that production company. The good thing is that sometimes they bring money to the table.
Sure.
An actor's question.
Yes.
In one of these sections here, you mentioned the bad boy contract.
Yeah.
And you did mention to actors, what does that mean? I've actually been in stage productions where somebody was hired, they were like the headliner for the production, they were the draw. People showed up and you had an entire company freaking out because you had to do a show every night live with somebody who came in so drunk and coked up that they would stop in the middle of a Shakespeare play and start screaming at somebody in the audience. And you as another company member, you had no recourse. It would go back to the theater.
I could give you 100 actors like that.
but what does that mean, the bad boy contract?
And I'll explain that too. A bad boy contract basically is they don't get dime one till the end of the shoot. So it's held by their agent, so the money's there. But if they decide to go on a drinking binge or whatever and not show up, and those people watch giving them a hotel room with that bar in the hotel room.
Are they ever long-term really blacklisted from productions? Why do people hire them?
Well, I know line producers and production managers will talk to each other. We'll say, well, we've got this person coming in. You also have the bond company that's supposed to be doing their job. I had Danny Baldwin, and so we had him on the set, and we've been shooting 2 weeks, and I get a call from the bond company. They go, you can't use Danny Baldwin. We shot him out yesterday. So bond company is supposed to be there doing their job. They're not sometimes. And he was great. Eric Roberts is great. You just got to be truthful with him. If he thinks you're bullshitting him, he knows it, he's going to be a pain in the ass. Anybody else?
Do you deal with any, or what's your experience with buyout contracts in the smaller budget world? Can you do that, or for SAG, in terms of getting a better situation for an actor where you're not, you're paying a bigger chunk, so you have them as long as you want. You have this rehearsal days built in. And does that question?
Yeah, you can do that. That's just a contract, between the agent and the actor.
Do you find that's more difficult in the low budget arena, or?
Well, the good thing is actors are really insecure about working. They don't want to be sitting at home for a year and not working. They want to get out there and work. As I'm sure our actors will.
Yes. So if you're shooting, let's say, non-union, low budget, would you suggest that the best thing to do is maybe to have a contract to give your employees, if you will, that states, if you show up, intoxicated or blah, 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 blah?
I have that built in my contract.
Okay.
I think I've only fired 3 people, and they were all night shoots. And these guys are real drunk, and they're carrying 10 Ks on their shoulders, and somebody could have gotten hurt, plus the damage to the lights.
Thank you.
Once you get your budget developed, are you going to talk today about where you take that budget and how you sell it and how you raise the money to do that in that movie?
I don't do that.
You don't do that?
I just spend the money.
Nice talk.
And the first thing is, never use your own money. Never use your own house. And try not to use your own car in a movie. Yes.
A question about when there's the production office is set up here. Say, this is a production from California. Comes in, they set up a production office, and then everything works out of that. Who are the people staffing the production office here when it's, say a film that the initial production, everything is set up in Los Angeles, and then comes here. Who mans that production office here?
Who mans it? Well, it depends.
Are the players there?
99% of the time, they're bringing their guys from California.
Right.
And they're paying those good rates. And, when you get into the multiple, tens of millions of dollars, what's a hotel bill? What's $60 per diem? It means absolutely nothing.
So it's the reliability. That's everything.
Mm-hmm. What I like to do is see them come here and have people that can take those middle management jobs.
What are the skills that people here need to have to be able to do that, to run a production office?
For a start, they need to know movie magic. Okay. There are other programs, like I said, but movie magic really is the whole what everybody in the industry uses.
How long do you think after just starting to learn movie magic to being proficient at? How long would it take before you'd actually trust somebody that they really know what they're doing with movie magic?
Well, I guess you got to kind of go out and see if your schedule that you've thought in your mind actually works with the crew that you're working with. Like I said, there are, you know, I try to keep my page count around 5 or 6 pages a day, depending on what we're shooting. If that's basically dialogue, that should be doable.
Talk a little about the value of using a treatment to sell the script. Is it done much more anymore? Is it what's the main avenue for pitching a film out there?
Well, what people say is, you know, the money for an option for a treatment is about zero. Unfortunately.
But I mean, do agents or do producers like to look at a treatment before a script, or they don't even bother with treatments anymore?
I think there again, it depends who you know. You know, for the most part, I don't see people getting any money for treatments. You might get an option. You might get $50 for an option.
Do you get them saying, I like your treatment, now go get me the script?
That might happen. And then I would say, okay, I want $30,000 for the first write of the script, and see how serious they are.
I was going to mention what your question is, that it's having production managers that are New Mexico based, like Alton,
Walpole,
same guy, Alton, Walpole, Marks. There's about 4 production managers that are bringing in the bigger pick that are going out to California, picking up the pictures, coming back here, and using their local office staff, including accountants and the whole thing. And, you know, to me, that's key to it, because once it's set up in LA, it's almost impossible to even get a job.
And you see, that the one thing I like to see them bargain for is to make the DGA have a trainer on the set, and that trainer's from New Mexico. They're not flying the trainee from California out here. And that way he could at least get his days to move up the ladder.
Are there no schools teaching any kind of directing?
Of what I see the schools here, and I don't know all the schools, I'd say you're either going to school here to be a director or producer, or you're going to be below the line. I don't see a lot of middle management classes. Anything else?
What got you into film?
What got me into film? What got me out of it? I did everything right so I could retire, move to beautiful Santa Fe. I got a beautiful house. And, you know, I don't have to work. You know, my wife used to tell me, for 30 years, you work 16 hours a day, you know, and now I don't.
Yeah, but what did you get back to her real question then? What got you into it?
What got me into it? Well, you know, I grew up in New York City for a while, and we used to go down Times Square, and you could just go see one movie after another for like 50 cents or a buck or something like that. And I had a friend, and we used to go see 10 movies a day. And we thought nothing of doing that. And then somewheres, you kind of just like get the disease, whatever you want to call it. And, you know, you just love it. You know, you love the action. I mean, I actually love being an AD a lot more than being a line producer. I felt like I was much more of a filmmaker. I mean, as you go up the ladder, the money gets better, but you're getting farther away from the camera. And like I used to use some of the same ADs all the time because, you know, we all work together. And they knew if I went to the set, something was wrong. I wasn't like the line producer. I didn't have to lean on them all the time. If something was going wrong, they would call me up or something. I'd be down there in a flash. But for the most part, I wasn't the type of guy that would lean over my AD's shoulders. You know, everybody knows their job in the professional arena. And most of them do a hell of a job.
So how old were you when you moved from New York to LA?
I actually went through Colorado first. And then I landed in LA. And my first job right out of school was a second AD for Papa Michael. He was shooting a small film. The first AD got a job with Hunter, which was a TV series, and then I became the first AD. So I was pretty fortunate. I didn't have to spend a lot of years going up the ladder. And what, you know, once you start knowing this stuff, it's easier to move up the ladder. I mean, I have several people I've trained in LA for production management work. I have one young lady who went to NYU who's just a genius. She's the line producer now. First thing I told her, let's go through the grip truck. You got to know every piece of equipment in there. Let's go through the electric. You need to know all that. Because you don't want somebody coming up to you going, oh, we ripped a floppy. And you're there going, oh, what's that? So it's very important if you're going to manage these people to know what their language is. I mean, you know, basically a grip, definition of a grip is somebody who lifts. So they've invented this language of their own so that, you know, we give them credit for being smarter. Okay.
Can I give you a specific example of that? I mean, I know you know everything, but...
No, I don't. I do not.
I worked with Tom Cruise's partner, Paula Wagner, and we were working on a movie here years ago, and we were watching the dailies with Michael Chapman, the DP, and we had a problem with the, in those days, we used what they call a crash camera, which is the IMO 35 millimeter. At one time, it was a wind-up camera. They converted it with a motor. And they had a problem with these things. So Michael says, oh no, we had a screw up with the IMO. And Paul says, what's an IMO? I mean, for a producer not to know the equipment that she's using, and this is a major screw up with this one shot deal of a big explosion and the one key camera screwed up, and she didn't know what an IMO was. So that's just an example of a really good producer should know all aspects of everything.
I worked with Dino De Laurentiis' company for a couple of years, and they used to bring their huge crews from Italy, and we'd shoot in Arizona. And the same thing, we have a stagecoach coming, and they go, we're going to dig this hole, and we're going to put the camera crew in there. I said, well, why don't we use an IMO? And they go, oh, yeah, that's a good idea. So now you know where all the money goes, I guess. Yeah, now you got a GoPro. I mean, I have a little Samsung that I just like stick any place, you know, it's great.
Wait, so what's an IMO?
IMO is usually a non-sync camera. The one that you're talking about, was it a bayonet lens?
Yeah, bayonet.
Yeah, bayonet lens. That you,
World War II.
Yeah, they used to use in World War II. We had to steal some scenes one time for a show in LA, and we used that because it was a wind-up. And we just took it on the subway, and we shot scenes in the subway, and it worked beautifully. You know, we had to obviously loop the actors, but you know, it didn't cost us a fortune to shoot it.
So it's just pure picture, and it's film.
Yeah, it's a non-sound.
Is it?
I mean, you may be able to sync it with a hard wire, but for the most part, you use it just for taking picture. Usually 16 millimeter, I think.
I think Warren Miller
or Bolitz.
Anybody else?
Tell us some good stories, juicy film stories.
Well, let's see. I'll try not to mention some names.
No, you got to mention names. That's a big deal breaker.
I would say one of my earlier films, which was kind of strange, is I did a film with Faye Dunaway as the director-producer. Now, it was called Yellow Bird, which was written by Tennessee Williams. And she got some money from Coca-Cola, but not a lot of money because she's got a name. What she did get was she got anything she wanted from Warner Brothers, which was, wow, this was nice. I remember doing a night shoot and my DP said, you know, I wish we had something more than that 5K. Got on the phone, guy comes out, you know, in the little cart, there's a 10K. I mean, I've never, and plus on the studio, you turn over the fire hydrant and there's a junction box there. So it's really nice and easy. And, but the thing with her, see, a couple of the funny things that happened with her there was, first day she goes, Oh, well, we had, she was a Academy Award winner, and then we had Brenda Bison, we had her, and then we had, remember the movie where the actor who was the the president's analyst? James Colburn? Doesn't ring a bell here?
James
Colburn. James Colburn, that's it. So we had three Academy Award winners on the show. We had no money for their dressing rooms. So I had these, like, I was embarrassed. We had like these just pieces of junk, you know, with siding falling off and everything. I mean, it was just, how could you have three Academy Award winners on something like this? And let's see. So one day she turned to me and she goes, I give her the checks and I said, you gotta sign these, you know, we gotta pay the crew. She goes, you know, I just don't feel like paying the crew today. I mean, and another time, like I said, the first time she gave it, she goes, so who's going to cook my pheasant eggs every morning? And I just looked at her like, you know, we're talking bagel and a cup of coffee on this budget. But it was fun, you know, with just being able to do anything you want at Universal. Anything else?
So if somebody, like, for people who are just starting and want to, like, get into line producing, what's their first step?
Well, I mean, I really think you need to work your way up there. I mean, you know, a father or somebody who got you in. I mean, I started out with Amanda and John Green. Jack Green was their dad. They were working as, one was working as an AC and one was directing this little film. Now, if you look at Law and Order, they're the executive producers. And, you know, good for them. They deserve it. They were out there in the trenches.
So that was where you first started being a line producer?
It wasn't something I really was looking to go. You know, it's just all of a sudden you're with, you know, I guess you're getting older and the kids are around you and you seem to know more than everybody else, so you get kicked upstairs. And I guess I had a very good reputation. I mean, I did a couple of foreign films where they personally gave me several $1 million and I opened the account. You know, and one time I said, well, you know, I hear you can get a real good deal on a house in Bali.
Difference between a line producer and a production manager?
I've done both. I've done all three. Basically, I kind of do it anyways. I mean, as a line producer, I still break down my script. I still do the budget. But then I'll hire people to run it. That way, I really know everything that's happening as far as money and as far as the script. And otherwise, I don't feel like I know it. I just can't go in and say, okay, hire this production manager, hire this AD, and, you know, let's go. That's just me. But certainly, I'll do the first breakdowns, and then I'll give it to the AD, and I'll say, you know, this is all yours now. And the same thing with the budget. But basically, the production manager does a lot of what this was on here, you know, like getting the crew together and the vendors and things like that.
So the union difference.
Pardon me?
The union difference.
Well, actually, a line producer is called co-producer. And so you could actually be a line producer and not be in the DGA. And you could, of course, also be a producer, a production manager, an AD, and not be in the DGA. But what they've done is they've opened up the DGA a lot, which is probably why they want to bring so many DGA people out here, because they got so many people unemployed, you know, who are DGA in LA.
How involved in the budgeting process are the department heads or key players?
Well, they usually say, I can't do it for this. And because I mean, there's kind of a rule of thumb on how much money you're spending, you know, for the departments. And you know, you've got to do with what you've got. I mean, I've done films where the wardrobe people went around to the actors' houses and drag clothes out of their closets. You know, it's about making the picture work on the money you have.
So you throw a number at them first, and then they come back and say yes or no?
Yeah, you know, tell you the truth, I usually don't give them the exact number the first time out, because I'm going to cover my butt, and I'm going to have a little pad in there, because I know they're going to come back and want a little more anyways.
How much do you pad it?
How much do I pad it? Well, you got to figure out, probably where people don't know much about is the posting, how much it costs to post the film. And so that's a good place to start. I saw one budget where they spent $300,000 on the sound design, and no offense for the sound design, but you know, my people do it for like $100,000, and that's not a big, that's a big production. So I mean, there's, you know, there's places you can do it. You know, you don't want to skimp on, like I said, you don't want to skip on the catering. You know, you really want, you know, you become a family after, you know, after the 2 weeks, really. It takes me about 2 weeks to get my crew together. And then everybody is just usually pretty happy.
Was there a budget limit or a budget amount that you would not go below that? You would not work on a film that was below this?
Oh, no. I love film. I mean, you know, right now I'm doing shorts for myself just for fun. So yeah, and you know, that's, you know, it doesn't really matter what it is as long as I like what it is. You know, if there's a storyline to it, I'll jump on it, sure.
So if there's a really good screenplay and someone wants to hire you, what would it take to get you to go back?
I don't know, but I think I'd offer it to my friend here.
Pierre, I kind of have two questions, and I hope I can be clear on them. Based on your experience, even though you're retired, you're, you know, you still have experience.
I hope so. It didn't go away. I haven't gotten that old.
Not at all. How do you see now developing the films that are being produced, whether they're independent or major? What kinds of movements do you see as the scripts are coming being produced? What kinds of ideas?
You know, I thought at first when digital cameras came along that they would give more money to the crews. That didn't really happen. Because it's all about the glass, and the glass is expensive. What I see is I see, you know, independents all over the world now. I've got two of my films in Cambridge Film Festival. You know, and, you know, I could have never made this two little films, you know, 3 years ago. You know, now you can actually buy an editing system, you know, anybody could buy an editing system and a camera and go out and shoot your dreams.
Did you shoot it as well as direct these films?
And I gripped it, and I PA'd it. And I loved every minute of it.
Can you tell us a little bit about the theme or the what you film?
One is called Coppapelli's Revenge, and it's the story of a Native American who is kind of hoodwinked into going out and stealing petroglyphs with this redneck for money. And you have to see the movie. Anyways, Coppapelli comes back with a revenge. Let's see, I've done a couple on petroglyphs, and that's kind of like one of my hobbies now. And I just did one that really wasn't it started one thing and then became another. It was going to be a music video for Placer Peak, which is the Ortiz Mountains out here. And because I work with Botanical Gardens a lot, I'm one of their docents. And so it started out as a picture and music thing, and then it kind of was going to be a documentary, and then it kind of landed up being a statement about the mine up there and about the programs, educational programs that are available in the Ortiz.
And my other question was, what about the future? What do you see in the future?
Independence just doing better all the time. I mean, I used to personally love it when a studio had a $60 million flop, and they'd go, you know, if we only had more time and more money, you know. Well, you know, it's the script, people.
What's the craziest example of something you've had to pull out of thin air to keep a production like completely tanking?
Okay, say that again first.
What's the craziest thing you've ever like had to pull out of thin air to keep a production on schedule or on budget or just completely collapsing? Like just the deal you made or?
I'd have to think about that one. There are quite a few of them. I'll get back to you if something comes to me.
So when the money's tight, it's low budget, how involved do you think the director needs to be or should be, and there's a second part to this question, in terms of knowing how to make the day, in terms of number of setups? And then what's the number of setups you would aim for in any given day when you're shooting six pages?
Well, I mean, I like to have 32, but I think in reality, you're probably going to get 32 setups.
32.
You're probably
getting.
One camera? One camera, yeah. You might get 14. So anywhere between that.
And do your directors on these low-budget projects, are they aware of this? That's what I'm noticing, is that they're not aware of how to plan a day, you know, number of shots. Or do you just not worry about
them? Well, you know, I always ask them for a shot list, and, you know, after 5 days, that goes out the window. But, you know, it's also, you know, this is why you need that strong AD on the set. You know, somebody who's going to keep the director aligned, keep them moving, keep the crew moving. One of my things as an AD, I never sat down. The minute you sat down, you know, you look around, all of a sudden the whole crew's sitting down.
A standby camera.
Standby camera, you got it. And the only time you're allowed to go is when you got to ring it out. Anything else?
You don't know how to put the question. How would it work to kind of go backwards, knowing, like working with a screenwriter and saying, okay, if you want to get this film made for this, start with, we're going to do this many setups, you need no more than this location.
Well, I think there's kind of a formula here. You know, around $1 million formula, I think what was it? It was like 10 locations, not more than 24 in the cast, you know, and you're going about 24 days, 20 days, 18, somewhere in there.
Did everyone hear that? That was a good one.
Okay. No. around $1 million, this is what it'll buy you for the most part. It'll buy you 10 locations, no more than 24 actors, and that's about it.
How many days?
About 24 days, 20 days, 18. Like I say, if I get in budget problems, the one thing I'll go to is adding page count and dropping the number of days in the shoot.
So what is 100,000 buy you?
It all depends what you can pull off, you know. If you can get your wardrobes free, I mean, there's a lot of people out there that, you know, obviously will work just to get the credit from IMDb. And then there's other people who do it just because they love it, you know, and do that. You're probably going to find your more inexperienced people, you know, at that level, unless you can, you know, call in favors.
Were you ever handed a script that you just totally didn't believe in? If you thought...
Half of them. Half of them, and I just say, this is really something else. Hey, I'm working for a living here. You know, if I turned down every script I didn't like, I would have, you know, I would have never paid the rent.
Yeah.